بارئ الخلائق أجمعين الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين المبعوث رحمة للعالمين شفيع المذنبين وحبيب قلوب الصادقين سيدنا ومولانا أبي القاسم محمد
اللهم صل على محمد
وعلى أهل بيته الأطيبين الأطهرين الهداة المهديين ولعنة الله على أعدائهم إلى قيام يوم الدين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي أما بعد فقد قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله فاطمة بضعة مني من أغضبها أغضبني صلوات
اللهم صل على محمد
Respected ulama, brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. As I did yesterday, I began today with the statement of the Prophet of Islam, Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa alihi. Which has been reported in different words and with longer or shorter narrations, but in the most concise and the shortest version, which is found with additional detail from the narrations of Ahlul Bayt, but at a very minimum, the sentence which is agreed upon in the authentic sources of all of the schools of thought within Islam, there is an instruction from the Prophet that tells us that Fatima is a piece of my flesh and my body and my being. What angers her angers me. Now, in the more complete version, the Prophet continues and says that what angers me angers Allah. And what pleases Fatima pleases me. And what pleases me pleases Allah. But even if we just take that minimum, yesterday I mentioned that one of the things that we can learn from this statement, if the Prophet only speaks that which is revealed to him, and if the Prophet does not ever let his personal love or his personal motivation get the better of him, if we know what it means to be a Nabi and what it means to be devoted to the path of Allah, if we know that the early Muslims were willing to go to battle against their own tribesmen and against their own cousins and their own brothers and even their own parents and sons for the sake of Allah, and not let that family relationship get in the way of their commitment to their Creator and the truth, and we recognize that the Nabi is the one who inspired them to put truth before all else, and therefore could never let a relationship get in the way of expressing the truth. If we know what it means to be a Nabi who inspired all of those manifestations of sincerity, then there can be no doubt from this statement that not only is Lady Fatima ma'asum and free of sin, but that she is far more than ma'asum. Because to be free of sin just means that you don't make a mistake. It doesn't mean that you will never be tempted towards a mistake. It doesn't mean that you will always be offended and always shrink away from and shudder from any kind of sin or mistake. It is possible for Allah to protect someone, but to do so without having protected all of their emotions and their feelings, but just to protect them in action from committing an error. But it is an even higher level of isma, where we are told that Lady Fatima's pleasure is the pleasure of the Prophet. Her anger is the anger of the Prophet. Her very emotional being is a representation of what Allah wants. This is what we talked about yesterday. Today, I wish to move that discussion forward, and we are going to be, inshallah, concluding what we have been looking at. And it is a supreme act of mercy for Allah to have given us on the human level a reflection of His love and His mercy and what He wants, and in fact what are the attributes of Allah when they come on the human plane. Let me repeat that. We say that Allah is Rahman, and we say that wasi'at rahmatuhu kulla shay, that Allah is of all encompassing mercy. When we say that He is Rahman, it means that His mercy is coextensive with the essence of Allah, such that even His wrath is a reflection of His mercy. Or as the Quran says, you can call your Lord Allah, or you can call Him Rahman, but you are calling the same thing because the most beautiful names belong to Him. So the mercy of Allah is the most all-encompassing of His attributes, but there is a level of that mercy that we cannot understand directly. It is impossible for us to understand directly. We can intellectually say that whatever Allah does must be merciful. But when we hear about all of the evil that exists in the world, all of the tragedies that exist, some of them are caused by human beings and human failings, and some of those tragedies are beyond the control of human beings. Disasters that we call natural disasters, or we call acts of God, they are acts of God, because they are in the control of God, even if they are not in your and my control to prevent. We hear about, for example, a young child that was with his or her parents, maybe camping in nature, and then might have been attacked by an animal and may even have died from that attack. And then we say, well, how can this be merciful? Now, on an intellectual level, we can say that there might be some mercy that is involved. And it is true that there is some mercy involved. Because just as Allah has created the human beings and the parents who have that child, Allah has created all of those animals, even the birds of prey and the predators that live in the jungles, even those snakes and those alligators and those poisonous animals that all of us are afraid of, and if it had been up to us, might have said that Allah, we shouldn't really create these at all. But Allah creates all of them, and He loves all of His creation, and He sustains them, and He sustains them by providing their food and their sustenance, just as He provides our food and our sustenance. Intellectually, we might be able to say that does make sense on some level. But if we are the ones afflicted by that tragedy, or if we are trying to offer consolation by somebody who has suffered such a tragedy, we have to admit that even we would fall silent and maybe not have words to express. That is not the time to tell somebody, well, there is a very beautiful ecosystem that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created. Because the time for that intellection is separate. But on a human level, we cannot always understand what it means to be merciful. Because we can never approach that infinite horizon of knowledge and rububiyyah and lordship that Allah has. So some people might say that it is almost impossible to develop a relationship with Allah at all. What does it mean for me to say that He must be merciful and everything that He does is merciful, if when it comes to an individual action in humanity or on this earth, I don't know what that mercy demands? I think that mercy demands that innocent children should not be taken away from their parents in tragic circumstances so that their parents are mourning for years or for decades. But if Allah's mercy is such that it allows for that to take place, then how can I put my trust in that mercy? How can I develop a relationship with the Lord, even if I know in my mind that He is merciful, but I can't understand His mercy? The question is clear. But the answer has come to us just as clearly. That don't worry about the mercy on that level of Allah's lordship. Because you are not infinite, and we are not meant to be infinite, and we can't understand all of the wisdom behind the sustenance of the entire universe. The level of that mercy that we can understand, and that Allah has given us enough to be able to appreciate, is the level of that mercy as it comes on the human plane. And the most perfect reflection of that mercy and all of the beautiful attributes of Allah on the human dimension and on the human level are the person of the Prophet and his progeny. Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Now I can say, without any doubt, without any hesitation, that if something causes tears to fall down the face of the Prophet, then it also evokes Allah's mercy. Even if on some level that I can't understand, Allah allows those things to take place. But I can understand on a human level what my reaction is to be and how I am to react. Because I can see what the Prophet would do and how the Prophet would feel. So it's important then for us not just to have, as all Muslims believe, a ma'soom who does not do wrong. But in order for us to understand those attributes of Allah, the mercy of Allah, the names of Allah, as they are reflected on the human dimension, it is essential for us to have a ma'soom whom we can say that even when what they feel is manifested, that is a reflection of what Allah wants. So it is not just a luxury that we have been given. It is essential to our guidance. And it is not the case that there is divinity in the Prophet or in the progeny of the Prophet. They are khalqun marbubun, created by Allah, and they are subject to the lordship and the guidance of Allah. But then Allah has reflected in them the attributes of His grandeur, the attributes of His mercy, the attributes of His running the affairs of the world on the level that we are able to relate to. And so that is why those who have been attached to Ahlul Bayt have been able to understand Tawheed far better than those who are not attached to Ahlul Bayt. One part of it is the sermons of Imam Ali alayhi salam and the sermons of our other Imams or their ahadith. Those ahadith, they tell us how we are to think of Allah and how we are to conceive of Allah. But that is not the whole story. They also remind us that when Allah has created us, when He has placed within our fitrah a certain love for beauty, an aesthetic sense, He has placed within us a certain time when we get angry, a certain time when we are happy, then each and every one of those emotions, just as much as each and every one of those intellectual thoughts, they are also meant to bring us closer to our Creator and to serve us in achieving our salvation and our perfection. And we can only do that if there is a model that we can follow. I don't have the time to explain the difference that there exists among Muslims about this point. We are followers of Ahlul Bayt, and so for most of us, this might seem to be very clear and very obvious, but if you look at the ahadith that are actually believed in by a large number of Muslims, there is actually a hadith which is found in the Sahih which says that once Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As, one of the young members of the Quraysh tribe, I was used to write down everything the Prophet would say. And some of the senior companions of the Prophet said, don't do that. Because the Prophet is a man. And he talks fil ghadab wal riba. He talks in anger and he talks in pleasure. And what if you write down something the Prophet said in anger and then people think it is revelation from God, but it was just the Prophet speaking as a human being? Or the Prophet talks in pleasure and it was just the Prophet talking about his personal love for somebody that was close to him, but it doesn't reflect what Allah wants us to know. Don't write it down. It's dangerous if all of those thoughts of the Prophet and all of those words of the Prophet are remembered too closely and too precisely. So these are ahadith, which are actually believed in and are actually taken as a statement of principle by a large number of Muslims. So we see the importance of recognizing the following of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salatu was-salam on the level of their ahadith and on the level of an emotional attachment. Now, where I want us to develop this perspective is to say that in some cases, because of our own deficient understanding, the intellectual understanding of Islam may not be always accessible for us in certain aspects. Yesterday I mentioned the example of divorce. And certain issues that do come up within our communities about divorce, the access of divorce that happens, for example, with a husband and with a wife. And there are differences that none of us should deny that, and there are issues that do come within our communities. The question may arise that, did I give a solution to that question? My point, though, was not what the solution is. I may tell you what the fatwa of one marja is, or I might tell you what a solution is, and some of you may think that it does not solve the problem, and some of you may still have questions. And that is the nature of our study of Islam, that there will always be new questions that will come up, even if we are able to successfully answer one question. I'll just give one new example today. There was a person who was studying Islam, a friend of mine, was working with them in trying to introduce them to the teachings of Islam, and they were convinced that this is the true religion. The beauty of the Prophet's seerah, the beauty of tawheed, the simplicity, the egalitarianism, the elegance of the religion, but they didn't become Muslim. Because they said that your Prophet never abolished slavery. How can a religion revealed by God allow a person to own another person, buy and sell another person? I can't accept this religion. It's a beautiful religion. And if it had banned slavery, I probably would have accepted it. So this is an example of something that some of us, we might never have really thought about. Because as Muslims, we know that it's not just a question of the Prophet accepting slavery. Slavery already existed. What the Prophet did is he very systematically and he very carefully legislated laws according to the inspiration of God that took the edge off of slavery. He prevented people from creating slaves as they used to simply for their own benefit. If the imams had not been sidelined from their imamat, then it is very likely that because of the severe restrictions that Islam had placed on slavery, it would have died a natural death. And within their lifetimes, the imams freed hundreds and even thousands of slaves. If you look at books of biographies of the companions of our sixth and our seventh imam, then you will see that many of them were the freed slaves or the descendants of the freed slaves of Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salatu wassalam. He would buy slaves. They were the refugees of the Muslim world at that time. Some of them were illiterate. Some of them had been literate in their own societies, but their families and their societies and their wealth had been decimated by death and disease and destruction. And they didn't know Arabic, so they weren't able to operate now in the new society and the civilization that had existed. So the Imam brought them into the noblest and the best household in Medina. And he raised them up. And when they were ready, and the Imam saw that they were ready, he freed them. And sometimes people would be surprised. They would even come to the Imams and they would say, why did you free that slave? One example from the life of our third Imam, Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wassalam. A similar incident has also been reported about our fifth Imam, but the incident is narrated about Imam Hussein as well. It is that once the Imam was going towards the public bath, and on the way, and he was accompanied by one of his slaves. On the way, the Imam saw a morsel of bread that was on the ground, that somebody had thrown away or carelessly discarded. And the Imam said that this is not good, it shouldn't be wasted. But he was on his way to the public bath in order to do ghusl, so he picked it up and he gave it to his slave. And he says, when I come out, then remind me about this morsel. And then he went and he continued on his affairs, and he came out of the bath. And when he came out, he said to that slave, that where was that morsel that I had given to you? And the slave said, Ibn Rasulullah akaltuha. O grandson of the Messenger of God, I ate it. And the Imam said that أنت حر لوجه الله, without hesitation, that now you are free in the path of Allah. Why free at that time? Because the Imam said this person is intellectually and spiritually ready to be a free person. They have recognized what the values of Islam are, how to treat even a morsel of food that somebody has discarded. And the Imam said that somebody who is that humble, somebody who is that conscious of not wasting, that they will wash and cleanse a discarded morsel of food and then not consider it beneath their dignity to eat it, even if they are being fed and cared for in the very best and the most generous household in all of the world at the time, Allah has said that that morsel will not come to the person's stomach until Allah has freed them from the hellfire. And once I know that a person is free from the hellfire, then they are not going to remain a servant or a slave in the household of Ahlul Bayt. So the Imam freed his slave. And people came and said that, why is it that you did this? And the Imam offered the explanation. This is the manner in which the Imams would buy slaves and train them and raise them to be successful in their material life and in their spiritual life, and to be able to raise their own families and be independent. And most of the time, those freed slaves would still attach themselves to Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salatu was-salam. Now, my point in mentioning this is that for many of us, this issue of slavery doesn't seem to be such a big deal, because we know this side of the story as well. But the broader point that I want to make, is it valid for a person to say that I love this religion, but the very idea that somebody can own another person is so beyond my conscience that I would never accept that religion if that is a belief? That is my point. Because no matter how beautiful that incident might be and how inspiring it might be and what it tells us about Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam and the methodology of Ahlul Bayt, it is a fact, is it not, that Imam Hussein had purchased that person and owned that person? And until that moment, if God forbid Imam Hussein had died, then that person would have been inherited by the heirs of Imam Hussein. Is it not the case? That is what slavery means, correct? And the answer that we must reach is that there are many things which, if we think we are able to judge on our own terms, we have to admit we don't have all the facts. To our modern sensibilities, when we live in stable societies, where no matter how down on your luck you are able to get some benefits as a refugee or as somebody who is going to get government assistance or private charities, and there are certain international organizations that will look after you, in this time and in this era and with our sensibilities, it might seem inconceivable that slavery could ever have been a lesser evil. But at the same time, we have to admit that if the Prophet had not chosen that sensitive treatment to end slavery or to reduce slavery and had just abolished it all at once, it is very possible that there might not have been physical slaves, but there would have been many, many more people who would have been killed at the end of every battle, because the victors would have no use for them. There would have been many, many more people who would have been shunned into ghettos and turned into a permanent underclass, because the victorious society would have no place for them and no way to bring them up within it. So in the end, a person who is looking at that teaching of Islam must say that whether I understand it or not, I have to start from what I know, what is timeless, what is the basis of making a decision about faith, about a momentous part of our life. And then I will proceed from there. But we can only make that decision if we are smart enough, and if we are humble enough, and if we have the presence of mind sufficiently to be able to recognize that there are many things that might seem obvious because of our culture and our society, but they are not necessarily as obvious as they appear at first sight. So the question is therefore not a matter of saying, what is the exact solution to this question of slavery? I and you can conjecture that had Islam gone along its original path, very soon Ahlul Bayt would have put an end to this institution. It was never something that Islam affirmed. But we can't say so with certainty, because Islam was taken down the wrong path, and Ahlul Bayt were not free to establish their teachings and the proper practices of Islam and lead the Muslim society entirely in the direction that it was intended to go. Similarly with every other question. It might be a question of marriage. It might be a question of divorce. It might be a question of the nature of society or civil rights or any other question that we have. Those questions do exist. Those problems do exist within our society, and it is not a matter of denying them or putting them down. But it is a question of us having the correct perspective so that we don't throw out the baby with the bathwater. There is a Chinese proverb that I have been informed is a Chinese proverb. I don't speak Chinese. But whoever said it, it's very beautiful. It says that in avoiding the mistakes that your parents made, and all of us, especially when we're young, we can list all of the mistakes that our parents made and are making. In avoiding the mistakes that your parents made, don't make the mistakes that your parents avoided. And we can only really appreciate that sometimes once we are as old as our parents now are. Once we have also gone through all of those stages of life, many of the things that we objected to so strongly when we were 15 or when we were 20, maybe when we were 30 or when we were 40, when we are ourselves past middle age and we have gone through those different stages of life, we look back with our parents or we look back with our grandparents and we say, God bless their wisdom. They actually knew many things that I thought they had no idea of. And it might not be my own parents, I might not have had that grace, but we can see it within our communities, we can see it within our societies. It takes a great deal of wisdom for us to be able to appreciate how we are to deal with situations that in many cases are beyond our full comprehension. And so this is the direction that I think as individuals, as societies, we need to move in. Many of our youth now, they are going and they are interacting with a society with very different ideals, with very different assumptions. And sometimes we come with these grand schemes that we need to reform our community institutions. That what is going on in the Hawza, what is going on among our ulama, or what is being said as our fiqh or our teachings, it is something which does not answer our questions today. And that is a necessary process of reform, of questioning, of trying to find out things that do not make sense to us so that we can gain greater insight. All I am saying is that it must be done with the requisite amount of humility. And we are followers of Ahlul Bayt. We are not followers of the school of the Khulafa. In the school of the Khulafa, if you and I or our Muslim community cannot get a conclusive answer, then it reflects poorly on Islam. Because how can Islam be a complete system if there is no conclusive answer that we have access to? But in the school of Ahlul Bayt, it doesn't reflect on the incompletion of Islam. It reflects on the human failing to be able to take advantage as individuals and as a society of the divine guidance that Allah has provided. So we use those temporary solutions. We take one step forward, that we have this problem within society. How can we strengthen our marriages? How can we assure that those legal and those fiqhi and those judicial procedures that our fiqh has given us that we know of can come to the use, for example, of those women who might be in need of a divorce legitimately, but whose husbands are reluctant to grant it? How can we ensure that this type of situation doesn't come about in the first place? And how can we ensure that this type of a situation can be resolved in the best possible way when it comes into being? We might not have that grand answer, but not having that grand answer is what reminds us that we need to turn to Ahlul Bayt. We need to turn to Allah and say that we are acting on the best that we have. But oh Allah, there is nobody and there is nothing. No matter how grand a society we can build, no matter how flourishing a community center we can build, no matter how learned and how pious our ulama and our fuqaha and our maraji' may be, no matter what a intellectual institution we might be able to create, there is no substitute for having an imam in our midst. The more we advance, if we advance with humility, the more we will feel a palpable need to have that imam present and to have the guidance of that imam. The questions and the issues that come up in our life that we don't find answers to, they will increase our iman. And that is what they are intended to do. They will not decrease and strip us of our iman. Please recite salawat. And that was what Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salatu wassalam did throughout their lives. If we look at the entire history of all of our ma'asumeen, starting right from the very beginning after the Prophet left this world. I've referenced several times the khutbah that the daughter of the Prophet Fatima Zahra salamullahi alayha gave. In the court of Abu Bakr. And it might seem to us counterintuitive. This is the khutbah fadakiyah. The khutbah which has been narrated about Fadak. It's also reported in somewhat similar wording in Nahjul Balagha on the authority of Imam Ali, but that doesn't mean that it is contested. Imam Ali also had a strong motive and desire to preserve the words and the wisdom of the daughter of the Prophet, and also the children of Fatima Zahra salamullahi alayha, including Lady Zainab, are among the narrators of this khutbah, which used to at one time be a text studied by the followers of Ahlul Bayt. It might seem counterintuitive to us that she is coming to make a claim about something that was her property that had been taken from her unjustly. And she says that, let me tell you the story of Sharia. That فَرَضَ اللَّهُ الْإِيمَانَ تَطْحِيرًا مِنَ الشِّرْكِ. Allah legislated, Allah has obligated faith to purify you from shirk. Shirk is filth. Shirk takes you out of the realm of humanity into that unclean realm of your animalistic existence, not recognizing your true purpose and the virtue and the nobility of your creation and what you have been created for. And then she mentions the purpose of salat, and the purpose of zakat, and the purpose of sawm and hajj, and the different teachings of Islam, jihad, and amr bil ma'ruf, and nahi anil munkar. Why would she do that? Because she wanted to say that the reason why you think that you can take fadak, the reason why you think that you can make decisions about Islam so easily, and so cavalierly is because you think you know Islam. You think you know what the purposes of this religion are. It's not you as the caliph and your body of advisors that are at fault as individuals. But it is this arrogance that comes from thinking that I know what's best for me. And if only I could have made my own tawzihul masail, if I could have written my own sharia, I would have solved all of the problems that society has. But we will make those mistakes, which is what sharia was specifically designed to avoid. So for example, Lady Fatima, she says that salat farad Allah al-imana tathiran min ash-shirk, that iman was there in order to purify us from the filth of our animalistic and our baser instincts and life. وَالصَّلَاةَ تَنْزِيهًا عَنِ الْكِبْرِ, and prayer was legislated to separate us from arrogance. This is something that we can see was historically and even in our own time forgotten. There are many people who pray 5 times a day, but then when they see somebody who might not have as good a prayer or as consistent or as regular a prayer, they have a sense of arrogance. All of us might have seen people, or we might know people, who have a special dua for Allah, and when that dua is not answered on our terms, they say that, "Oh Allah, I never missed a prayer, and I make a single dua, and you don't answer my dua in my way. You can't do this much for me after I have spent a lifetime serving and worshipping and obeying you." So Lady Fatima, she said that your salat has a purpose. And sometimes when we forget that purpose, we might be praying, but we don't benefit from the effect that that prayer is intended to have, because we forget that prayer is not simply something that we put on a checklist so that at the end of the week we can make a spreadsheet, we can say that we have 35 wajib prayers, and if we're lucky we have certain nawafil and tahajjud and other prayers as well. Please recite salawat. Prayer is meant to be something which increases our humility. And if we want to have meaning in our prayer, if we want to be able to concentrate in our prayer, it's not enough for us to go and to ask somebody, "How can I concentrate in my prayer? I get distracted." We think that the solution is to pray some way differently. We think that the solution lies in, for example, somebody telling us a zikr, a certain dua that I can read. If I do one tasbih of this zikr, then I'll be able to concentrate in the prayer. In some cases, the solution does not lie in what we do just before the prayer, or what zikr we do, or how we try to force ourselves to concentrate during the prayer. But the difference lies in us being able to understand that the prayer is meant to make us a certain person, and the prayer can only have meaning for a certain type of person. If we have kibr, if we have a sense of our own grandeur and a sense of arrogance and conceit, concentrate as we will not be able to perform a salat. It is who we are that will determine whether we can have the tawfiq to concentrate in our prayer and whether that prayer will be effective. On that same point, it is sometimes helpful for us to improve our prayers by doing things outside of our prayer. I know some people who are trying to improve their prayers and they are concerned, they have a greater degree of dedication to Islam than I do, because I will not generally recognize the deficiency in my own prayer and then try to repeat it. But these people will say, "I did the dhuhr, and after I finished the dhuhr, I realized that I was only concentrating for part of one rak'ah, so I'll repeat it. And then I realized that I got distracted again, and I'll repeat it again." So there are some people who do that in order to try to concentrate. But the ahadith tell us that one way that you should improve your prayers is by doing the nawafil. In fact, the nawafil have been legislated in order to rectify the deficiencies that naturally creep up within our prayer. So if we want to, over the long term, develop a plan to improve our dhuhr prayer, it's not by just repeating our dhuhr prayer itself. We might continue to stand in place. But what it is by doing some of the nawafil and by changing our environment outside of the prayer. One thing that is very helpful is when I know that I'm going to get distracted, let me take some time before my prayer and think of all of those things that potentially will distract me. I have a paper due, and I should have started it 2 weeks ago, but I didn't. And so I have to collect my books, and I have to write an outline, and I have to quickly take care of that assignment, and it's going to distract me during my prayer. Let me think about it ahead of time, that I'm going to start it right after my prayer, and I'm going to do this now, and even if I need to, write it down. What tasks do I have to do? Let that come out of my system before I come to the prayer. Create an environment that is conducive. Make a commitment that I will make an effort to do the nawafil. Change the environment outside of our prayer. And most importantly, make a commitment to be a more humble person. And over time I will see, not immediately, but over time I will see that I will be able to concentrate better in my prayer without really having to make that deliberate effort that can sometimes be self-defeating. So Lady Fatima salamullahi alayha, she said that prayer is meant in order to take you away from kibr. And prayer is only going to have meaning if you don't have kibr in you. She says, for example, that faradallahu al-jihada izzan lil-islam. Jihad is meant to give izzah and grandeur and strength to Islam. We see many people in today's time and throughout history declaring a jihad at the flip of a switch and at the drop of a hat. They declare jihads that turn people away from Islam. Forget non-Muslims, that turn many Muslims away from Islam, that cause divisions and strife within society and loss of innocent property. In fact, that was some of the ways that jihad was declared even from the earliest days. And so Lady Fatima says that to understand jihad, you have to understand the purpose for which jihad was established. If your effort, even in spite of your sacrifice and your willingness to become a martyr, is going to weaken Islam or divide Muslims or cause innocent people to lose their property and their dignity and their lives without reason, you might think it is a jihad. It is a noble struggle. But it is the furthest thing from a jihad that can be attributed to Islam. So this is the way that Lady Fatima salamullahi alayha, she wanted to tell people that I'm not coming to you just to ask you for my right. Take fadak. Because she knew that they were not going to give her fadak. But there was a reason why the caliphate said that we want to keep fadak. They said that we are going to send our armies on conquests. And this profit that is going to come from the agricultural land of Fadak, it's going to go to buy weapons for our soldiers. It's going to go to buy the swords and the shields and the armaments that are going to allow the conquests to take place. And Lady Fatima is saying that what conquest are you going to take when you are doing so by stealing property that does not belong to you or to anyone but those who were bequeathed it by the Prophet? Every teaching of Islam, the prayer and the fasting and the hajj and the zakat and jihad and amr bil ma'ruf and nahi anil munkar, everything has a purpose, everything has a place. And if I think that I can understand it on my own terms, I can open up a lot of territory, but I will not be able to serve Islam. Sooner or later, my ignorance will catch up with me. And it will catch up not just with me, but all of those that I may have misled or misguided. In Islamic history, we see that there were some people who understood that right when Amir al-Mu'mineen and Lady Fatima salamullahi alayha raised the slogan of truth immediately after the death of the Prophet. And there were many people who came sooner or later. A few people were loyal right after the death of the Prophet. They were among those who barricaded themselves in the house of Lady Fatima and withheld their allegiance to what they knew was the wrong path. But they were very few, and for various reasons they had to disperse. Amir al-Mu'mineen also did not enforce his right at that time. But it wasn't just until the death of Uthman, when the masses came, that people began to realize. If you look closely at history, you will see that even after the death, or even before the death of the second caliph, it is said that there were rumors in Medina, and people would say various things. They would say that when the second caliph leaves, I will not do bay'ah to anybody but so-and-so. Now, history likes to censor certain things, especially general history. And so-and-so is not mentioned. But that so-and-so becomes clear from the context. One person here and one person there was saying that the only person who can restore the purity of Islam, the egalitarianism of Islam, the principles of Islam, is Amir al-Mu'mineen. And so those noises had begun to be heard and had begun to shake the halls of power. And that is why, unlike the first caliph, the second caliph said that I am going to have a council of six people. If you know the personality of the second caliph, he was very decisive. Even in the time of the Prophet, he would say we should do things this way and not that way. Even if it was the Prophet, he would immediately come and say that it's this way and not that way. It's not in the personality of the second caliph to have a council of six people, especially when the precedent had been set by the first caliph that there is going to be a direct appointment. And that was considered to be valid. That is how he himself became a caliph. Why have six people? Because he knew that there was a credibility gap. Because people wanted Amir al-Mu'mineen, and so he had to admit Amir al-Mu'mineen, but he said, let me dilute this by adding in the other people who are not submissive or not loyal to Amir al-Mu'mineen. On the surface, it's as if I have given him his due, I've given him a fair chance. But within, the same trajectory that had continued from Saqifah was able to continue. That change that took place, this was because of that superficial understanding of Islam. And our challenge as believers is to recognize that Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salatu wassalam were willing to sacrifice their personal well-being, to sacrifice even their name and their reputation, to sacrifice their safety, to sacrifice anything that they had been given by Allah in this world, in order to preserve the essence of Islam. One incident towards the end of the Prophet's life is so beautifully illustrative of this point. It is said that Amir al-Mu'mineen once, after working hard through manual labor as was his wont, saved up some money and bought a gold necklace for Lady Fatima salamullahi alayha. There could be no more halal earnings than the earnings of Amir al-Mu'mineen. And there could be no more valued possession to Lady Fatima than that sincere gift that had been given to her through the hard work of her husband. Not because it was gold. Had it been something very simple, she would have valued it equally much. But the Prophet came to his daughter. And as was his wont, he would visit her frequently, but when he visited this time, the report tells us that he couldn't take his gaze off of that necklace. He said, Fatima, what will people say? Because you are as I. It's different if you had been one of my other members of my household. It's different when it comes to my wives. There is no report in history where the Prophet ever told any of his wives to give a prized possession in charity. Because they had one role, and Fatima was being preserved and prepared to serve as the symbol of all that is beautiful of Islam. He didn't have to say anything beyond gaze at the necklace. And as soon as the Prophet left, Lady Fatima called for Amir al-Mu'mineen. She said, thank you for this gift, but I want to honor this gift in the best way that I know how. Take this, sell it in the market. Whatever money is given, buy a slave and free that slave for the pleasure of Allah. And the Prophet heard about it. And he said, Fatima is from me. and I am from Fatima. This is what the There is nothing wrong with the halal risk that Allah has given. But these are our role models, not to be attached to that halal risk. Always to be looking for what the best use is. And that sincerity, that readiness. There was courage. There was generosity. There was devotion. There was all of the beautiful attributes that we could see in the teachings of Islam represented in the household of the Prophet. And it was these teachings that Lady Fatima, she passed on to her children. She had four young children. And many of us, when we hear about the fact that Lady Zainab narrated the hadith of Fadak, when we hear about how much Imam Hussein remembered his mother, we hear about Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein and Lady Zainab talking about their mother, we might think that they lived a long time with their mother. But all of them were young children when their mother left this world. She left that strong impression. She taught them those lessons when they were still young children, because that is the type of mother that she was. It is said that in her final days, Lady Fatima, for at least 40 days before she left this world, was too weak to walk. She had been injured. But she had been injured not just in body. She had been injured to the very depths of her soul because she was not even able to mourn her father. And in spite of that weakness, whenever she felt the slightest bit of strength, she would call Asma or she would call Fidla and she would say, "Bring my children to me." And they would tell her that, "O daughter of the Prophet, right now it is your job to recover your strength because we feel that you will weaken yourself. If you do anything for your children," she said, "then O Fidla, O Asma, you don't know how much I am going to miss my children. I know what is going to happen. Bring my children to me." And even if she had to lean on the body and the arms of Fidla, she would bathe her children with her own hands. She would put their clothes on them, comb their hair, feed them with her own hands. And she would say, "My children, remember these moments, because if it were possible for your mother, she would not let you leave her side for even a moment. But these are the memories that I wish to leave you with. Remember who you are the heirs of." And it was in those moments that many ahadith were taught by Lady Fatima to her children. She told them stories of the courage of Hamza. She told them stories of the sacrifices of Lady Khadija. She told them stories of the purity and the sincerity of Ja'far al-Tayyar. She said, "My children, there will be a time when each and every one of these stories will be your inspiration and be your consolation. Do not forget your mother's words, and do not think that your mother in death is not by your side as you go through each moment within your lives and within each challenge that you are going to face." Jab janab sayyida ki shahadat hui to aapke charo bacche kam sin the lekin janab sayyida jaisi maa ho to chote chote bacche bhi buzurgwar hote hain. Jab zindagi ke aakhri lamhat the to janab sayyida ne apne bachon ko paas bulaya تمام بچوں کو وصیتیں کی لیکن دو بچے تھے کہ جن کو خاص وصیتیں جناب سیدہ نے کرنی تھی. امام حسین کو پاس بلایا, جناب زینب کو پاس بلایا, کہا, "میرے پیارے بچوں, کاش میں زندہ رہتی اور آپ کے ساتھ کربلا جاتی, لیکن اللہ نے مقدر کیا کہ میں اس دنیا سے جانے والی ہوں. اے میرے پیارے حسین, ایک وصیت سن لے, جب جناب زینب سے ودا کرنا تو ماں کی طرف سے سلام کہنا, صبر کی تلقین کرنا. اس وقت زینب کو صبر کی تلقین کی ضرورت ہوگی. ماں کی طرف سے جناب زینب کو بوسہ دینا اور بتانا کہ جب ردا چھینی جائے گی تو ماں اللہ کے دربار میں جانے کو یاد کرنا اور پھر زینب کی طرف رخ کیا کہا بیٹی میں کیسی وصیت کروں بھائی سے جب رخصت ہونا تو ایک یہ میری رومال بھائی کو دینا یہ وہ رومال ہے کہ راتوں کی عبادتوں کے دوران جس سے میں اپنے آنسو پوچھتی تھی کربلا کا دن آیا دسیوں برس گزر چکے تھے جناب زینب اور جناب حسین علیہ السلام کو وہ وصیتیں یاد آئیں ودا کا وقت آیا تو امام نے اپنی بہن کو پاس بلایا کہا کہ اے میری بہن ماں کی صلاۃ کا سلام قبول کر ماں نے پیغام دیا ماں نے دعائیں دی جناب زینب نے کہا بھیا میری بھی ایک وصیت ہے جو ماں کی طرف سے مجھے پہنچانی ہے ایک رومال آگے بڑھایا بھائی کی طرف سے دونوں نے ماں کے آنسوؤں کے آثار کو دیکھا آنسو بہائے ماں کے آنسوؤں سے بہن بھائی کے آنسو مل گئے بہن نے پیار سے محبت سے وہ رومال بھائی کے سر پہ باندھا اور مایوسی سے بھائی کو ودا کیا کربلا کے میدان میں جاتے دیکھا بھائی کا دلیرانہ جنگ دیکھا لیکن ایک وہ گھڑی آئی کہ جناب زینب دیکھتی رہی اور وہ جنتی رومال خون سے لہو سے لال ہوا وہ سرخی دیکھی برداشت نہ ہو سکی آسمان کی طرف زینب نے رخ کیا کہا محمد صل علیک ملائکت السماء اے میرے جان رسول خدا جنت کے فرشتے آپ پر سلام بھیجے یہ آپ کے نواسے حسین ہیں کربلا کی مٹی میں اور وہ اب خون ان کی زمین سے مل گئی اس منظر پہ کیسے صبر کیا جائے اللہ لعنت اللہ علی القوم الظالم اللہ سبحانہ وتعالی count us among the sincere followers and the loyal people who will carry on the torch of Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salatu wassalam to our future generations. And may Allah grant us the opportunity to witness with our own eyes the appearance of the Imam of our time and the establishment of truth and justice throughout the world. If we are not able to witness it, then may we pass that heritage on to our children and to our future generations. May Allah grant us the intercession of Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad in this life and in the hereafter and their company for all eternity. May Allah forgive our sins and our shortcomings and answer our prayers and the prayers of all mu'mineen throughout the world. I beg your pardon if I have said anything or if there have been any deficiencies in my attempt to convey the message of Ahlul Bayt. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive me and all of us and guide us to increase our knowledge and our sincerity and our piety. Let us remember all of those believers who have left this world and pray for them with the Surah Fatiha.